Okay, Mr. and Mrs. Smith, thank you for coming in today. I've already gone over all of your data, finished your exam, and we've talked about the things that you've had done in the past. And I want to step back and just talk about atrial fibrillation a little bit in general. I know that you've done a lot of reading and have a lot of this in your mind already, but I find sometimes it's best to step back and assume no previous knowledge and start right from scratch from the beginning. So forgive me if I cover things that you already know all about. Atrial fibrillation, as you know, is a disease of chaotic electrical movement in the upper chambers. What we should have with the heart is lub-dub, with the upper chambers followed by the lower chambers in order. And atrial fibrillation, the upper chambers don't just lub and then relax and wait for dub. They have continuous chaotic electricity moving in various cycles around it. So what that means is they sit there and just quiver like this. There's no effective pumping action, just this quivering movement all the time. Because they have electricity going all the time, they are constantly pounding the lower chambers with electrical signals, some of which get through and some of which don't. So the lower chambers tend to go very fast and have an irregular beat to them. If we think about that then, it leads us to what the three problems are associated with atrial fibrillation. And you're aware of some of these already. Problems caused by atrial fibrillation include the rapid ventricular response, or when the upper chambers are constantly pummeling the lower chambers to beat, they go like this instead of having time to relax, fill, beat, relax, fill, beat. They're going like this very fast. That never gives them time to relax all the way and fill. So the effective pumping is diminished because they're too fast. They don't have time to fill and get a good stroke or stroke volume, as we say. One of the second problems associated is when the upper chambers are just sitting and quivering, there isn't good emptying of them, and blood tends to be static in them. Now, you might recall that we've talked about the left atrial appendage in atrial fibrillation. And I've made another quick diagram of it here. If this is the back of your left atrium, and it is, and these are the veins feeding in from your right lung, these are the veins feeding in from your left lung, there's this little side room off of here called the left atrial appendage. It stands to reason that that's where clot is going to form. And when the atrium isn't beating well, clots tend to form in here, then break off and go downstream. If they go up to the brain, which is where they usually go, they tend to lodge in the brain and cause a stroke. So the second problem with atrial fibrillation is clot formation and stroke, because the upper chambers are not moving and pumping effectively. Finally, the third problem associated with it is what we call loss of the atrial kick, or we talked about the lower chambers relax, fill, and then pump. Part of the job of the upper chambers is to give a priming kick to the lower chambers. In some patients, that priming volume is very important, and they don't do well without that priming kick. Some patients do very well, and they barely notice the loss of it. Those are the ones that do well with medical therapy and staying in AFib. You haven't done well. You've been very symptomatic with it. So let's talk then about what some of the treatment options are for atrial fibrillation, okay? And then I want to come back around to you, what you've had already done, narrow down what your treatment options are, and present you with some choices that you can go home and think about and discuss, and I'll help you get to whatever treatment option you decide is the best for you, okay? First, is rate control and anticoagulation. Now, if you think about that, what this is doing is it's treating two of our three problems caused by atrial fibrillation. It's not treating the loss of the atrial kick. Rate control and anticoagulation means we're going to leave you in atrial fibrillation. You may have heard of, read about the Affirm trial or some other trials, and there are varying trials, some of which say patients do very well in atrial fib, and some do. If we can prevent the two biggest problems, which are the rapid response to the lower chambers and the clot formation and stroke. Let me pause and talk about that again, because it's very important to control the rapid response. The other thing that happens to the lower chambers, if they're beating very rapidly all the time, is eventually they give out. And instead of being able to squeeze like this, you're left with lower chambers that can just go like this, and patients go into heart failure. The beautiful thing about that type of cardiomyopathy, if you will, is it's reversible. If we slow the ventricle down, it will come back to normal again. So rate control is extremely important aspect of all treatments of atrial fibrillation, because if we don't do it, the heart is going to fail. So rate control and anticoagulation means we give you drugs to slow down your rate, we anticoagulate you so that you can't form clots, and leave you in atrial fibrillation. You haven't done well with that, because you're very symptomatic when you're in atrial fibrillation. Some patients do well with that. Doesn't seem to be a good treatment option for you. Now, I know this has been mentioned to you, so I want to put this in perspective. If we can't get rate control with drugs, the other way to attain rate control is to burn the electrical connections between the upper and lower chambers. Then, when the body's own pacemaker, which is up here, spreads a beat through the upper chambers, it pauses and then goes to the lower chambers. If we burn the connection between them, we've obtained great rate control, because the lower chambers aren't going to go. And because they aren't going to go, we then have to put in a pacemaker to drive them at a set rate, say 70 or 80 beats per minute. And the newer pacemakers are very good. They will sense when you're active, and they'll speed up for you. They'll sense when you're not active, and they'll slow down for you. So that is the ultimate rate control, is 80 node ablation and insertion of a pacemaker. But it's really just comes under the role or heading of rate control and anticoagulation. Okay? The next type of therapy is to get you, and we only have five therapies to choose from, so it makes this very easy. All of the other four are aimed at getting you back into normal sinus rhythm. Lub dub, lub dub, lub dub. First is medical therapy. Put you on medications that will convert you back into normal rhythm, or do a cardioversion for you, shock you out of it and into normal rhythm. And that's great for some people that have atrial fibrillation once and they never have it yet. It's great for people that are able to be controlled for long periods of time on a single medication. Now that gives me pause to stop and talk about atrial fibrillation and how it presents. Atrial fibrillation starts in most patients with what we call paroxysmal, or they go in and out of atrial fibrillation on their own. That lasts varying periods of time. I've seen patients that have been paroxysmal for 20 years. But they all progress, everyone progresses down the path from paroxysmal to persistent to long-standing persistent. Persistent atrial fibrillation means you go into atrial fibrillation, you no longer come out on your own, but you will come out if we shock you. Long-standing persistent is the next step. You go into atrial fibrillation, we shock you, and you won't come out, or you'll stay out less than 48 hours. As you progress through those stages, the success of treatment diminishes. So we have the highest success rate for paroxysmal atrial fibrillation and the lowest for long-standing persistent atrial fibrillation. Why am I talking about all that? Because cardioversion for you makes no sense, because you go right back into atrial fibrillation. So it's not a treatment for you. Medications you've tried, you have failed both Flecainide and now Rhythmol. And remember, you were getting very good control with Rhythmol last year, and this year you're having 3 to 4 breakthrough episodes per week that are causing you a good deal of symptoms. And that's a very common progression. Patients start breaking through their medications, and then it's going to fail to control you altogether. And then we're going to have to go to a medication that's more toxic that we don't like to use in a young fellow like you. So that's medical therapy. Probably not a good choice for you because you're breaking through the medications now and you're very symptomatic when you do. And cardioversion isn't going to work for you because you go right back into atrial fibrillation. That brings us then to the next three treatment options. And the next three treatment options are all an intervention that is done on your upper chambers. To understand that, we have to know if these are muscle fibers of your upper chamber, they spread electricity, one fiber to the next. So they will be like this. If this one fires, it'll make this one fire, then this one fire, like this. But effectively, it happens so fast that they all go together. Now, a scar is insulating to electricity, and that's the basic premise of the next three treatments. So if we put a scar right here, these three will go. This one is not going to go, because electricity is not going to jump that scar. So the next three treatments are all involved in putting strategically placed scars on the upper chambers of the heart so that the electrical wave starts here. It has to pass through the corridors that we've created for it and then down to the lower chambers. It cannot keep going in circles. It looks much like that thing in your Sunday paper, enter here, exit here. Only one path goes all the way down. But if you follow each of those paths, eventually you touch every part of the maze. So electricity will cover the whole atrium. It will all contract. Only one path will go down, and we cannot have what we call reentrant pathways or circular movement of electricity. This was first worked out by Dr. Jimmy Cox. And in 1996, he came to the third iteration of this operation called the Cox Maze 3. Now, Cox Maze 3 is very effective treatment, but it's a big operation. It involves opening your breastbone, putting you on the heart-lung machine, going inside the atrium on both sides, and doing a series of burns inside the atrium, sewing those all back together, closing it up, taking off the heart-lung machine, closing up your chest. It's a lot of surgery. And usually we reserve that for people that also have another problem. They have a problem with their valve down here that needs to be corrected, or a problem with the coronary arteries that need to be bypassed. And we reserve it for what we call concomitant surgery, if you need a maze and something else. So that's a lot of surgery for you. Probably not our next best treatment option. After Dr. Cox developed this operation, guys with the catheters tried to replicate those lesions by burning them with a catheter tip instead of cutting the scars, forming the scars by burning lines on the atrium. And that's the basic tenet of catheter ablation. A catheter ablation means, as you know, putting a catheter in your groin, feeding it up through your heart, puncturing across the septum, right here, that's between the two upper chambers, so that we can get into the left atrium, and then burning a series of burns in the left atrium, trying to affect all of these lines on the left atrium. Now think about that for a minute. That's difficult, because you're working through two fulcrums, a floppy catheter, a fulcrum in the groin, a fulcrum in the heart, and a two-dimensional black and white screen. Burn, 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 burn. These guys are very talented, but this is a lot of burning to get done and to try to get all this done. And it's not surprising that sometimes catheter ablation doesn't work. It needs to be repeated or go back again. You failed catheter ablation. You've had one catheter ablation, had brief control of your Afib, and it's come back. The next step is what we call the minimal access maze, and that's what you've been sent here today to talk about. Now, Cecile's already spent some time going through the operative details with you together, and hopefully that was all clear what we exactly will do in the operating room. The minimal access maze involves three small holes, one for the scope, two other for working instruments. So the scope acts like my eyes, the working ports are like my hands working inside. And we try to put these burns on the surface of the heart, get a burn that goes all the way through the atrial tissue to cause the scars that we need to channel the electricity in the direction that we need for it to go. So let's talk about what are reasonable options for you. Rate control and anticoagulation is not a good option for you because you're so terribly symptomatic when you're in atrial fibrillation. So probably not something you're going to want to choose. We could do it, but you're going to have to modify your lifestyle. And as a young guy, you've indicated that's not something you want to do. You want to be able to continue to travel, enjoy sports, and someday face retirement and continue to travel with your wife and have fun. Probably not a good treatment for you. Medical therapy we talked about, you failed one drug, you're failing your second drug. The next drug, amiodarone, is not a good choice for a young guy like you because the number of years you'd be subjected to it can probably cause problems in your lungs, your eyes, and in your thyroid over the long haul. The Cox Maze 3 is too much surgery for you, and I wouldn't offer it to you at this point, so I'm taking that off the table. That wouldn't be a wise thing for me to offer to you at this point. It's just too much surgery. Unless you were to need valve surgery or coronary artery bypass grafting, and if we get to the point of talking about operating on you, we're going to screen for those things. If it turns out you do need some coronary arteries operated on, or you have a valve that's leaking too bad, we're going to want to fix that all at the same time, not have to go back in a year or two. That would put the Cox Maze 3 back in the option list. You've had a catheter ablation and failed it. That doesn't mean you can't go back and have another. And if that's what you decide to do, I'm happy to get you back into the hands of an electrophysiologist who will go back and do another catheter ablation. Or I think the minimal access maze is a very good treatment option for you. Now, what are the success rates? So let's talk about that a little bit. Our success rate, you're no longer paroxysmal. Were you paroxysmal, we give you a success rate. Notice I say success rather than cure. I've taken the word cure away because I can't tell you what's going to happen 15 years from now. We don't know. So let's call success getting you out of atrial fibrillation. Success rate, where you in paroxysmal, would be 85 to 90%. But you're not. You're in what we call persistent. That drops you to the 80% range. If you were long-standing persistent, you'd be in the 75% range. Now, let's talk about what success is, because that's very important. You're going to read more about this on the internet, I know you are. And when you're going to compare other people's studies that say we have a 95 to 100% success rate, be very careful what you read and in comparing studies. There is now an international consensus statement that defines success. And success is defined as no more than 30 seconds of atrial fibrillation on a long-term monitor. So when you read people's papers, be careful what they say success. I saw one the other day. The fellow said, we have a 98% success rate, and we define success as no more than 3 days of continuous Afib. Really? That's not success. We have held to rigid record keeping of our patients and a very strict definition of success. So amongst our failures, we have many very happy patients that are having 2-3 minutes of atrial fibrillation silently in the middle of the night. I have to call that a failure. But the patient's burden is diminished so much that they're really very happy. So that's what we call success. For you, I'll quote you 80% for your persistent. A repeat catheter ablation is probably going to get you first catheter ablation for your type of surgery, probably 30, some guys up to 50% success. repeat catheter ablation somewhere between 50 to 60% success. And it diminishes the more catheter ablations you have to have. So I think these are your two reasonable choices at this point in time, and I'm happy to get you into either one of those that you want. Why don't I stop talking for a little bit and see what questions I can answer for y'all. Did you have any questions for me at this point?
When do you get to go off of Coumadin?
Most people want to come off of Coumadin. So remember the statement that I talked about, the international consensus statement? The international consensus statement is not silent on this point. And it says, once on Coumadin, always on Coumadin. We haven't held to that. Most people want off of Coumadin. We've talked about CHADS scoring. Has anybody talked to you about CHADS scoring? Mm-hmm. No? So there's a scoring system that says whether you should be on Coumadin or not when you have atrial fibrillation. It's called the CHADS system, and it's an eponym. C stands for congestive heart failure. You haven't had congestive heart failure, and you get 1 point for each of these. H stands for hypertension. You've had a little bit of hypertension. That gives you 1 point. A stands for age 75 or greater. You're younger than that. No points. D stands for diabetes. You're not a diabetic. S stands for a previous stroke, mini stroke, or TIA, transient ischemic attack. You actually get 2 points for that, okay? People that are CHAD 0 or 1, this statement says, can be effectively treated with aspirin alone. So although you are on Coumadin right now, and I want you on Coumadin, the strict definition says you could be on aspirin alone. So I have no problems taking you off of Coumadin once we restore sinus rhythm and have your atrial appendage removed. Remember, we're going to get rid of this appendage. This is a source of 90% of the strokes. So even if the operation doesn't work, we've reduced your stroke risk by 90%. You're a CHAD score 1. Getting rid of the atrial appendage drops your stroke risk by 90%. And therefore, we'll take you off of Coumadin. People that have CHADS scores 2 and 3, I will sometimes take off if we prove on a long-term monitor they have absolutely no AFib. The exception to that is anyone that's had a previous stroke or mini stroke, I leave on Coumadin for life. Is that more answer than you wanted?
That's great.
Anything else I can answer for you now?
You're ready to schedule your surgery.
Well, all those... I'm understanding to get back to where I was when I was a little bit younger before I had all this problem. This number 5, the minimal access maze, will get me there the quickest
or the best right now.
It's your surest way with one procedure.
Okay.
But I want to stress, it's more to go through than a catheter ablation. It's real surgery. It has real discomfort, real time off work, real days in the hospital.
And what's my time off of doing anything, the rehab time?
I think Cecile probably covered that a little earlier, but it's about a 3 or 4 hour operation. You'll be in the hospital hopefully 3 days, get you home on your third day. Probably not going to want to work for about 2 weeks just to get your strength back. Now you have a desk job, and if you can do some of that part-time, you can start going back at the end of a week, but you're not going to want to go back to 40 hours. It's going to be a full month and a half, 2 months before you're ready to do a 50, 60 hour week. Because it's going to take you a while to get your strength back. And you'll see at the end of a 40 hour work week, you're pooped. You don't work 8 hours, come home and say, honey, let's go dancing. You lay down and want to rest for a while. It takes a while to recover.
Okay. Are there any other questions?
Okay. So y'all can go home and think about this. Call me with the final decision, and if you want to move forward, we'll tell you the next steps to proceed. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Pleasure.